I think that is started to run deep. We see it again in the Suez Crisis of 1956, which was undoubtedly the most important foreign policy matter of the period. As you'll know, it began when the crisis began, when Nasser, the Egyptian president, nationalized the unilaterally nationalized the Suez Canal. And there was popular outrage. Billy Butman, the man who ran Butman's holiday camps, had his finger on the pulse, and he refused to allow Egypt's brilliant swimmers to participate in the annual Butman's cross-channel swimming race. They've got the Suez Canal. I'm not going to let them have the English Channel. And at the same time, we're in late July 56, the future Foreign Secretary, David Owen, was about to go up to Cambridge. He was working on a building site in Plymouth at the time, to earn some money before he went up. And rather painfully, he discovered that his fellow workers were adamant from the start that the Egyptians should not be allowed to get away with it, that the jippos hit us, so we should hit them. Over the crisis, over the next 2 or 3 months, public opinion did fluctuate a bit. At the point of the military intervention, the Anglo-French military intervention, public opinion was about even. But what's interesting is that when, within 3 or 4 days of that intervention, the Americans effectively pulled the plug on the British and the French by withdrawing financial support from Britain. There was such dislike in Britain of this sort of high-handed attitude of the Americans that actually opinion hardened behind the government, the anti-Eden government, on as it were, anti-American grounds. The final strand, I was whizzed through it, I think, in terms of as a unifying element of British society in the 50s, well, it was to do with values, really. And of course, these are intangible and difficult, at times difficult to be sure about. But I'll just mention five, and perhaps not to give examples: deference, respectability, conformity, restraint, and trust. I'll repeat them: deference, respectability, conformity, restraint, trust. And it's a cluster of values, of high values, but I think we're somewhere near the heart of certainly, as it were, mainstream British behaviour in the 50s. These were behavioural norms shared by the majority of the population. And just to mention on the last one, the trust point, it was a justified trust in the sense that crime figures were remarkably low. Compared with how they later became. Let me just compare 1957 figures with 1997 figures, so a 40-year gap. Just two examples. Notifiable offences reported by the police. 1957, just over 500,000. 1997, almost 4.5 million. So an 8 to 9-fold increase in those 40 years. Violent crimes against the person. Less than 11,000 in 1957. A quarter of a million in 1997. That must be 20 times, wasn't it? As an increase. I mean, these are starkly different figures. So we are talking about, you know, really quite different societies in some sense.